I'll go ahead and watch the Jets-Miami game. Go ahead, but I'll tell you right now, you miss a hell of a show here if you do, because in Jim Lowe's New York tonight, well, it's Mack and Mabel night. Last night, Mack and Mabel opened on Broadway with Robert Preston and Bernadette Peters and Lisa Kirk. And I want to tell you right now, it was some show, and I've got the people on with me tonight. All the aforementioned, plus producer David Merrick, director Gower Champion, the scenic designer Robin Wagner, Carol Channing was there, Earl Wilson, and many more. And you'll hear it right here in Jim Lowe's New York.
Comes in the room, the faded sofa stands a little prouder. That bunch of artificial flowers might even bloom, and I can feel my heart beat a little louder.
Mabel Comes in the Room from Mack and Mabel, the story of Mack Sennett and Mabel Norman, two of the early luminaries of the silent screen. As I say, I went to David Merrick's party after the performance last night, after the opening performance, and I had a chance to talk to all the people, and you'll be hearing them tonight in Jim Lowe's New York. Before we visit with David Merrick, first I'd like to give my review of Mack and Mabel, which opened last night at the Majestic Theater. I don't care what you may have read or heard elsewhere, Mack and Mabel is a lovely show. First, it contains a stunning performance by the electrifying Robert Preston, too long gone from Broadway. As the pioneer movie producer Mack Sennett, he moves, prances, dances, rides on camera cranes, slides down poles, and defies you not to watch him. One wonders why he hasn't done a one-man show at the Palace or Winter Garden or Minskoff. Several with considerably less to offer have. Then there's Bernadette Peters, who finally becomes a full-fledged theater star right before your delighted eyes. Her waif-like vulnerability make her perfect for the tragic Mabel Norman, one of the big stars of Mack Sennett. They shared a stormy, sometimey, and unhappy love affair between 1912 and her death in 1930. Then there's Hollywood in the teens and 20s. Mack Sennett's soundstage, the orchid room of the Hollywood Hotel, Sennett's bathing beauties and Keystone Cops. Seldom has a scenic designer gotten more mileage out of a stage than Robin Wagner, who even utilizes the catwalk. The score by Jerry Herman, like all of his scores, has been and will be criticized. Some will say it sounds overly familiar and formulaized. I have a feeling that Berlin and Porter were similarly criticized. Granted, Jerry Herman is a traditional writer, not an innovator. But his songs always work for the show, and at least one of the tunes, called I Won't Send You Roses, is almost heartbreaking in its directness and simplicity. Lisa Kirk's great tap dance also deserves a bow. My one reservation is with the direction of Gower Champion. You have the feeling that it wasn't quite pulled together as tautly as possible, and the closing with a quick, bare announcement of the death of Mabel Norman seems abrupt, to say the very least. But no matter. Mack and Mabel is a lovely show. It's tuneful, and it made me laugh and cry. What else is there? Mr. Merrick, could I intrude on you just a second here?
No intrusion at all.
Congratulations on a wonderful, lovely show.
Well, thank you. I gather you liked it.
I really did. I thought it was wonderful to begin with. That sort of my era in nostalgia, the 20s and 30s in Hollywood.
Well, I've had quite a number of openings. This was number 86. And there was some electricity in the air tonight. The audience, certainly, it succeeded with the audience.
Electricity in the audience and on stage, too, in spite of the fact that one curtain fell right toward the end.
Yeah. But that was a minor mishap, I suppose. Well, it's up to the critics now, and you're one of them, so I'm happy you liked it.
For what it's worth, I think it'll run for a long time. I really do. It's sad. It's happy in the beginning. It turns into a poignant story, and I think that it's going to be translatable into a long run.
Well, I hope so. Certainly, I know about the audiences. We had four previews before the opening. The audiences love it, but we have to get past a few critics to get it to the audiences.
Well, now, you're an old hand at First Night, as you said, 86, only a slight exaggeration for emphasis. I guess your first was...
Oh, no, this is the 86th Broadway opening.
Really?
Yes.
And it all started with Fanny?
It started with Fanny.
Mm-hmm. That's been these 20 years now, hasn't it?
20 years, yes. Yeah.
And you don't look a day older.
Oh, well, I do, of course. We both do, I'm sure, but...
I was going to say, you're an old hand at this sort of thing. How did you read the audience tonight? We're sitting here talking at about 10 o'clock. We haven't read any of the comments yet.
Well, I had very few friends there, and it was a smash response from the audience, so I would say, from the audience point of view, it was a great big, big hit. Based on former experiences with my shows and other people's shows. But it depends on a few men, depending on what the critics say, because there won't be audiences unless they say, go.
Well, it seems to me, looking back over a period of the 20 years, that a big musical is more apt to get by with a mix to good than a straight player comedy, isn't it?
Well, not any longer. There are only three papers now. They used to be eight, and then you had a mathematical chance, even missing the very important New York Times. But now there are just three papers, and you really have to make it with the New York Times, Daily News probably. And I don't know how important the television is now. But you have a very narrow target to shoot for these days.
Indeed. Well, Mr. Merrick, again, congratulations. And one thing I must say, in the half dozen times I've met you, you've always been so gentlemanly and so kindly that I discount all these ferocious stories I hear about David Merrick.
Well, thank you very much. I think I am gentlemanly. I don't know if I'm kindly, and I don't mind those stories. They get a lot of space.
In spite of the fact that you don't like our native Missouri, I'll forgive you for that even.
Oh, no. Are you from Missouri? That's right, you are. Well, I'm a New Yorker now and have been for such a long time, I can't remember any other place.
But I've been here the 20 years since Fanny myself, so it's my home, too. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Glad you're on.
Jerry Herman, congratulations on a wonderful score.
Oh, thank you, Jim. I'm I'm just coming down. I've been kind of numb for a few hours. You know, it's 3 years of my life that came to a head tonight.
What are the last few hours like?
Well, it's like the few minutes before you go to the electric chair, if you can visualize that.
I'm sure it is. 3 years this project has been in the offing, huh?
3 years, and it all comes to a head in 2 hours on opening night.
You always have one song that just absolutely grabs me. And in the show tonight, it was I Won't Send Roses. And coming up to the party here on top of Time Life, there were people in the elevator singing the song already.
Well,
now, that's got to be a good sign, right?
That really thrills me because, you know, we've played the show in Los Angeles, in San Diego, in Washington. And at every performance, I hear people hum on the way out, and really that's what it's all about for me.
Oh, absolutely.
If I can make people do that, I feel I've succeeded.
And there have been so damn many shows in recent years that you couldn't do that in. That's one of the reasons I always look forward to a Jerry Herman score.
Well, thank you. I believe in songs. I think that what is wrong with the musical theater is that we don't have as many songs today as we did in the 30s and the 40s, and I'm trying to do my part.
Well, don't you think that one of the problems today is that in the old days, the record companies that had the cast album, say it was Columbia, then automatically Stephen Eady would do a song, or Tony Bennett, or Andy Williams. Well, this doesn't happen anymore. And I think that used to help make hits.
Yes, that's very true. Also, the style of American music has changed, and rock scores are not Broadway scores for the most part, with one or two exceptions. But in spite of that, for example, I have a record right now of When Mabel Comes in the Room that's climbing on the charts every week.
It's a good record. We're playing it on the station.
Oh, terrific. And it's the Michael Allen record. And we're invading territory that is really foreign to show music, so that thrills me.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, a good song is still a good song. Michel Legrand still writes hit songs.
Oh, he certainly does.
He's essentially a 30s writer, really.
Yeah. He's melodic. People who have a melodic gift just turn me on. My favorite composers are
Jerome Kern out there.
Exactly, Kern and Porter and Berlin. I love Irving Berlin because you hum Irving Berlin when you hear it once, and that's what it's all about.
Before the fiddlers have fled.
Da 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 da. Yeah,
lovely,
beautiful.
Now we're talking at a little after 10 o'clock. The reviews are not out yet. Are you pretty nervous?
I'm very nervous. I'm always nervous before notices come out, especially after you've invested, you know, as much of your life in one project as I have in this. But I certainly think the performance went beautifully, and the audience liked it. And if the critics are kind to us, I think we're going to be in very good shape.
I just asked Mr. Merrick if, after all these years, I think he said 86 openings, if he could sort of read an audience. And he said that he felt good vibes tonight. He didn't say vibes, but that was what he meant.
I felt good vibes, but I'm not going to celebrate until I hear officially.
Well, I expect a couple of the critics will say that you have written one formula song, you know, like Mame and Hello Dolly. I don't care. It belonged in the show, and that's fine.
I would like to say that I fully expect that, and I write those kind of songs knowing that I will be criticized for them, but I write them because I believe that's what's missing from our musical theater, and I'm going to go on writing them.
Well, Jerry Herman, God bless you. Keep on writing them because it's wonderful and wonderful to hear. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim.
Hello, Dolly. This is Louis. Dolly, it's so nice to have you back where you belong. You looking swell, Dolly. I can't tell, Dolly. You still growing, you still growing, you still going strong. I feel the room sway, but the band's playing one of our old favorite songs from way back when. So take a rap, fellas, find an empty lap, fellas. Thank you. of our old favorite songs from way back when. So, golly gee, fellas, have a little faith in me, fellas.
I don't know what's going to open or not.
Well, David Merrick said a while ago, and it's very true. Of course, in the old days, there were seven newspapers.
Yeah.
So if the Good Gray Times didn't like something,
yeah,
and say four or five of the other papers did, it would tend to soften the blow.
That's right.
But today, there are only three.
Unfortunately.
Yeah.
Unfortunately.
Yeah.
Don't get the spectrum you really should have.
Yeah.
For a thing as important to so many people as this is, you know.
Mabel Norman really had a tragic life. She died in 1930, as you say in the show. I would imagine she was only 40, 45, something like.
She was younger than that. She was only in her young 30s.
Is that right?
Very, very tragic thing. She was a young woman when she died.
And he went out there in 1912, I think the storyline says,
yeah.
Mack Sennett did. And that was a year even before DeMille and Lemley and people like that.
That was just the burgeonings of it, the whole beginnings, that whole move and the growth of the California movie industry.
Yeah. Mary Luce told me the other day that Cecil B. DeMille wore those boots because of rattlesnakes when he first went out there.
Oh, wow. Well, I'm glad it's been explained. I never heard that, so now I know.
And I guess there are a few still out there after all these years, right?
Yeah, I guess so.
Well, Gareth, very nice to talk to you. Congratulations on a wonderful show, and good luck.
Thank you. Great pleasure.
Well, some big night.
Hey,
how
are
you? Nice to see you.
Right. Congratulations on the show they did for you over to Joe Franklin's. That was great.
Oh, thank you very much. Did you enjoy the show tonight?
I loved the whole thing, didn't you?
I sat there in tears in that second act. It was very sad. I loved it.
Well, the girl is so versatile. Of course, Bob Preston ran away with everything. But this girl whom I saw in Dames at Sea, I guess, and then On the Town, I believe it was.
Mm-hmm.
She played a lady cab driver, as I recall it. And she's so versatile, and she just, I didn't know she could dance as well. I didn't remember.
She knocked me over when she came in the room, because in the show tonight, of course, she was a brunette, and in real life, apparently, she's blonde.
Well, she...
She's versatile in that respect,
she's blonde,
too.
And she... And in fact, at the time of On the Town, Dames at Sea, we referred to her as a bit of a Marilyn Monroe lookalike.
That's
bouncy,
true.
Sexy
That's
quality.
True.
She was just wonderful tonight.
You love her, and she's not even from Ohio, right?
That's true. I think she's from Queens.
I believe so,
and,
yeah.
Her real name is Lazare, L-A-Z-A-R-R-A, I think it is,
uh-huh,
which is, of course, Italian.
Uh-huh.
And her mother and father are here. And another thing that's very interesting, you might be interested in this, Jim, there's a Mabel Norman here who is a niece of Mabel Norman.
Really?
And she lives in, grew up in Staten Island, and she's got two grown sons, and she's a very young-looking woman. She'd be like a... Well, her father was Mabel Norman's brother.
Is that right?
And her name
is
Mabel.
She's
sitting over on the other side over there.
Well, I'll go catch up. Thanks for the tip.
Okay, Jim. See you later.
Nice to talk to you. And now let's talk to charming, delightful, talented, vivacious Bernadette Peters. Bernadette, congratulations. It's a lovely show.
Oh, thank you. I'm so glad you like it.
You broke my heart.
But we love the show. You know, we really love it. The show has a lot of heart to it. And I think that's always good, you know.
Yeah, I almost touched you once. I sat on that little side seat right by the stage.
Oh, really?
I was almost part of the show.
Oh, right? Really? How did it feel being up there?
I loved it. In the show, you're a brunette. You're a blonde in real life.
Yeah.
I can't help but notice.
Well, Mabel Norman was a brunette, and I'm so thrilled her family is here. And I think it's her niece who looks like her. But when she said she saw me up there, she got so upset because I looked so much like her that she got very moved.
Laura Wilson told me that she was here.
Uh-huh, yeah. And that they loved the show and they were happy with it, so I'm so pleased.
Uh-huh. Does the show reduce you to tears?
Does the show what?
Reduce you to tears? Does it make you cry after all these weeks of doing it? The part is so sad, so poignant.
Yeah, well, I tell you, I think after the curtain came down tonight, I did kind of want to go, you know, after all these months, you know. But it's been so pleasant. It hasn't felt long. It's been so pleasant.
I haven't seen you since Dames at Sea. I fell in love with you then, just unabashedly.
That's a long time ago, yeah.
Yeah, 3 or 4 years now, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, it's nice to talk to you, dear.
Thank you, nice to talk to you.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Bye-bye.
should be in much more. I just had the whole audience adored you.
Thank you.
Oh, you were just Mabel Norman.
I saw you. I saw at the curtain call. I see pop, and there's Carol Channing. She stood up.
Oh, yeah, I couldn't help it. I couldn't help it. I just thought, doggone, she's everything a musical comedy queen ought to be. I just loved it. And so feminine and so... And everybody cried their eyes out. This show is a work of art, and you are a work of art in it.
I hope it... Well, I love it. We all love it.
Oh, yes. Oh, you must. You must love it.
Yes, we do.
Oh, my God, it's beautiful. And it was electricity in the air tonight.
Oh, I'm so glad.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. And so bad for you. And we kept saying, isn't it wonderful that Preston and Peters are such nice people that it should happen to them?
Well, I love Bobby.
Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm leaning over the back fence.
Oh, Jim Lowe, you're not.
I'm a shameless gossip. I really am.
Oh, I didn't know. I didn't.
That is terrific.
Wasn't she just
beautiful? Oh, she's wonderful. I just talked to her. She's absolutely marvelous.
I couldn't help standing.
Yeah.
I just couldn't help it. And Bernadette said she saw me.
She did?
Yeah. When she stood up in the curtain call, I said, well, oh, look, it's Carol. She's standing up. Carol Chan.
Well, Carol, you're kind of hard to miss. Face it.
Well, first off, I have these shoes on, so that makes it difficult to miss me.
And you're at every opening that you can go to. Sunday's your dark night with...
Sunday's our dark night.
I understand you do a Sunday matinee.
See, Jim, this is my family. That's why I'm so terribly happy. This is our family.
This is like, our champion,
Mr.
David
Merritt. Michael Stewart, Jerry Herman, The whole Hello Dolly family. And now Bernadette is so beautiful. And I mean, I wanted her to be what she is and more.
Well, she's wonderful.
And you know, Bob Preston, isn't he a king?
Ah, electricity.
Dynamite.
I would love to see the two of you together in a show sometime, you and Bob Preston.
Oh, I couldn't. I can't come on. When I see a show like this, all I can think is, my God, isn't it just perfection the way it is?
It really is.
It really is.
I just said to Jerry Herman that probably some critics will carp a little bit because there's a formula MAME Hello Dolly song in it, but I don't care. I think it works for the show, and I think it's good theater, and I'm talking about when Mabel comes in the room.
Well, it really is legitimate in the show. I mean, she laughs and she comes back.
Yeah.
You know, so it is legitimate.
Yeah.
The trouble is Jerry keeps writing tunes that people cannot stop singing, so they compare them.
That's right. I told him coming up in the elevator tonight, I don't have to buy the cast album now. A lady was singing I Won't Send Roses.
I love that.
Isn't that a great song?
Oh, it's so beautiful.
You know, the one I love is Time Heals All Wounds.
Oh, yes.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. That is chill time. Bernadette sings that way up on stage right, way up in the proscenium. See, the wonderful thing about this show is that it breaks so many of the rules of theater.
That's
and
right.
And opens musical comedy out into a whole new world. Gower broke the bars, you know, the formula.
Well, they get a lot of mileage out of the stage. They even use the catwalk. They use everything,
yes,
don't
everything.
They?
Yeah. Everything.
Yeah.
And Bernadette comes soaring out across... And Bob Preston, he's a king. You're a king and a queen up there.
And that crane that they have you on and have Bob Preston on just makes it. It's wonderful. Yeah. Well, it's so great to talk to both of you.
I don't know when an opening night was this electric.
No. You felt it in the... I asked Mr. Merrick, I said, you've had a lot of openings. I said, is there any... can you read an audience? And he said, to the extent I felt that there was a lot of electricity in the air tonight.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Here's another lovely lady, Miss Lisa Kirk. How are you? Good to see you again,
dear.
Good
to see you, Jim. It's been a long time.
I haven't seen you since we were both on the Walter Winchell TV show.
Oh, you're right. That's
in 19...
Right. How are you?
But, wow, that tap dance of yours really broke it up.
Thank you. Thank
you.
You
do it so beautifully. Of course, I knew you were a dancer as well as a great singer, but... Wow, you really get it going. The audience always loves a strong tap dance number, don't they?
Well, I think they enjoy a good tap dance, yes.
I once read that the legendary Marilyn Miller turned down Showboat, and they said, why? She said, there's no tap dance number halfway through the second act.
Oh, no, really? I didn't know that. Did you enjoy the show?
Big point?
Did you enjoy our show?
Oh, I loved it. Absolutely loved it.
Wonderful.
Laughing and crying, the whole thing. That's what it's about, isn't it?
You bet. Yeah, you bet. Oh, it's so good to be back.
And I guess it's great for you to be back on Broadway again, huh?
It really is.
Back where you belong.
Thank you, Jim. Yeah.
Nice to see you, Lisa.
Thank you. It's good to
God
see
bless.
You, too, and God
Bye-bye.
Bless.
Thank you.
Lisa Kirk, and before that, Carol Channing and Bernadette Peters, as they fell in each other's arms, and Carol congratulated Bernadette, and Bernadette thanked Carol for being there and for standing up, and it was lovely. And they professed not to know that I was eavesdropping with my tape recorder. I think they had a pretty good idea.
Before the parade passes by, I'm gonna go and taste Saturday's high life. Before the parade passes by, I'm gonna get some life back into my life. I'm ready to move out in front. I've had enough of just passing by life. With the rest of them, with the best of them, I can hold my head up high. For I've got a goal again, I've got a drive again. I'm gonna feel my heart coming alive again before the parade. Look at that crowd up ahead. Listen and hear that brass harmony growing. Look at that crowd up ahead. Pardon me if my old spirit is showing. All of those lights over there seem to be telling me where I'm going. When the whistle blows and the cymbals crash and the sparklers light the sky, I'm gonna raise the roof, I'm gonna carry on. Give me an old trombone, give me an old baton before the parade passes by.
Passes by. Listen and hear that brass harmony glowing. When the parade passes by, pardon me if my old spirit is showing. All those lights over there seem to be telling me where I'm going. When the whistle blows and the cymbals crash and the sparklers light the sky, when the parade blows, I'm ready to carry on. Give me an old trombone, give me an old drum before the parade passes by.
From the original cast album of Hello, Dolly, Carol Channing, with whom we spoke a minute ago.
Robert Preston, you big lug, you had me in tears there on that stage tonight.
Yeah, well, you're a pushover. We've known this for years, you know that.
It must have been exciting for you because I didn't know this. I read in the playbill that you grew up in Los Angeles, and I expect you're not quite old enough to remember the Mack Sennett days, but you remember chase scenes. I expect you remember when most of Los Angeles was an outdoor set, right?
I remember when they used to pay my grandmother $5 to use her porch when soldiers were marching, but we didn't know who the soldiers were, but they were in some movie that turned out to be something like Behind the Front or something like that, and they would stack their rifles on the middle of Lincoln Park Avenue and take a break on our lawn, and my grandmother would make a fast $5, which was great. So we were in pictures for a long, long time.
You were born in Massachusetts, weren't you?
Yeah, but the family moved to Los Angeles when I was 2.
What was it like growing up in Los Angeles in those days? Because, as we know, it wasn't really until the 30s or 40s that L.A. became, like the fourth or fifth largest or third largest city as it is today.
Well, we were as close to Los Angeles as you can be by a streetcar ride. And yet it was out in farm country.
Yeah.
And then when you went out the other way, which we used to do when I was 5 and 6 years old, in my father's Model T Ford to drive to Santa Monica to go to the beach, we went through Hollywood, which was Hollywood, was still part of Los Angeles, but it was Hollywood. And then Beverly Hills, which was just beginning to burgeon, and down the bridle path on Sunset Boulevard. And always there was someone like Hobart Bosworth on a white horse, because that's the way he took his bows all day Sunday to the people going to the beach.
Really?
Which was a marvelous old ham, you know?
Yeah.
And this is what I remember about the thing. When you do a show like ours, they enjoyed the ham of it, and they loved what they did, and they were doing what they considered a public service, you know. And then driving back, we didn't need a map that the, you know, there are people who stand on the corners and sell you maps of movie stars. We knew where everybody lived, but it didn't make that much difference to us. We weren't, I don't know what this, we weren't that impressed, but we were part of the same scene, I think. We used to sneak into the Selig Zoo through the Brahma bull cage. We had a little hole dug under there. No one would ever expect that kids of 7 and 8 years old were going to sneak into the zoo through the Brahma bull cage. And part of the zoo was Selig Studio. Selig was Selig Zoo and Selig Studio. And all the early Tarzan pictures were made there. And I'm, now, let's see, I do, this has to be before sound. I'm 56 years old.
Well, you certainly don't look it.
Well, I'm glad. I don't want to look it tomorrow either. But the fact that they were doing these things in 1926 and 27 means they must have been silenced. So we did see them make them. But it didn't, we never stopped as kids. It didn't stop us from going swimming or fishing. We had what we had to do, and they were doing what they did. And so I think growing up in that sort of atmosphere.
Did you ever see or meet Mack Sennett?
No, my father did.
Was your dad in the movie business?
No. My father lives where he lives today. He's sitting over there.
Is this your father over here?
Right there.
Ah.
Our house in Brentwood is right across the street from the great big old estate that Frank Fay used to have.
Uh-huh.
And all of the people were always over there every Sunday. And my dad met Mack Sennett many, many times. He says I'm playing him very well, except not mean enough. I thought I was being pretty mean.
Well, yeah, I guess he had his irascible side. Of course, all the movie moguls did back in those days. I guess they had to get anything done.
Well, I've talked to people like Tay Garnett. He was one of the best directors I ever worked with, and he was a coffee gopher and a writer and a stuntman and an actor and then a director for Sennett. And he said they hated him with an unholy hate, and they loved him. They all quit 40 times and came back 41 times, you know.
Yeah, I'm sure.
But that's what the business was like then, and I think that's the frenetic, hectic kind of thing that we're trying to do.
I remember one time, right after The Music Man, or during that time, Time Magazine did a cover on you, and they quoted you as saying, you went to Cecil B. DeMille, and you said, Mr. DeMille, I don't want this part, I don't like this part. He said, why not? It's the same one you played in Union Pacific.
No, I said to him, it was the same one I'd played in Union Pacific and in Northwest Mounted Police. Yeah. Well, he did that. The old people did that. They had a stock company. And if you remember the old days of studios, in talking, now I signed in 1938 at Paramount. We were a stock company. Warner Brothers certainly had its stock company, so did Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer. And if you weren't careful, you were playing the same role. And so, you know, Joan Blondell played that, and Cagney played that, and Pat O'Brien played that, and it was the same at Paramount. Ray Milland played that, Fred McMurray played that, I played this, and Paulette Goddard played that, Dorothy L'Amour played that, and we were stock company, and it was funny. You're having such a ball that you never even realized that these things were going out and people were seeing them.
And that actually you were making history at the same time.
Certainly
okay.
I never thought of that, yeah.
I'm hung up on the early days of Hollywood, as I guess you can guess. Do you know Adolph Zucker?
I have known Adolf Zucker since 1938. So to this date, and what is he, 100 now, isn't he? Didn't he?
I think so, yeah.
Well, he's going to be, if ever a man will make 158, Adolf will.
It'll be Adolf Zucker.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, Bob Preston, I don't want to keep you from your dinner. You've been wonderful to talk to us, and there was electricity in the air tonight. We're still waiting for the reviews, but I'll be surprised if they're not good, because the audience just absolutely adored it. If they're not good, then there's no connection at all, no rapport between what people think and what critics write.
I'm so proud of our entire company, because I don't think the show has ever been played better. It was not an opening night. It was just a whole love affair with this company on stage tonight. It was a marvelous thing, marvelous experience.
You must have gotten great vibes from the audience, too, from the moment you walked out.
Yes.
Very unusual. You walk out, I've never seen this before, you do your walk-on in the dark, but your voice is so well-known that they start applauding when you start talking.
Yeah, before the thing went up, before I came out. Yeah. Well, that's all right. That's an opening night. That we don't expect that to happen. But it's kind of lovely. Also, I've been away for about 7 years, and a lot of people are saying, stop making those damn movies and come back down to Broadway, which I'm glad I was able to do.
I think the best movie ever made was The Macomber Affair.
I do, too.
Yeah,
lovely movie. I'd love to be able to make it now with the new so-called permissiveness of this screen, so we could
work
with that
Hemingway
story. That's right, yeah.
Robert Preston, God bless. Thanks
babe. You may be.
Well, old friend, that's just about it for tonight. And it's been quite a night, if anybody just happened to jump out and ask you. David Merrick, Gower Champion, Robert Preston, Bernadette Peters, Lisa Kirk, Jerry Herman, Carol Channing, Earl Wilson. If I'm leaving out anybody, I'm apologizing right now. Jim Lowe's New York again tomorrow night after the game. God bless. This is WNEW Metro Media Radio in New York.